Everybody, good morning to you all, and welcome once again to the third part of our webinar series. Today we will focus on understanding whether self-employability can be an option for employment. We have enough research of career patterns and our understanding of employment. Unfortunately, the potential of self-employment as a career choice has been ignored or even rather underrated, even though it represents a substantial portion of a country's labor force. Many today are being forced to reconsider other options for their livelihoods. And we are seeing that grow, due to various reasons. We find ourselves in such a situation today. But the art of the transition is in the stitching together the various parts of a career and work life into a compelling business proposition and finding a way to monetize a skill or a passion. In this scenario, can self-employment be a viable option? And if so, how? These are the two questions we would like to address today. At the same time, please do keep in mind that we are talking of all three labor classes in India, which is the white collar, the blue collar, and the no collar. Your moderator for today will be Mr. Shiv Kumar Tohan. He is the Vice Chancellor of Erne University, and he himself has been a serial entrepreneur. So, Shiv, over to you. Take it from here.
Okay. Thanks, Roy. So, may I request Sumit to start this webinar with their opening remarks? Sumit is from Times of India and Times Foundation. Sumit, can you please?
Good morning, everyone. I'm Sumit Assis, and I represent Times Foundation, which is a social wing of Times of India Group. When Times Foundation and Whiteboard Labs thought about this series of webinar, we thought of doing something good for the people who are suffering from this COVID-19 situation, especially the professionals who are on the verge of losing their jobs or who wants to establish their second career. And I humbly welcome all the panelists, and I believe that today's session will be very enlightful for those who want to start their own businesses.
I'd like to introduce my eminent panelist for this webinar. We have Dr. Ranjit Mehta. Dr. Mehta is the Principal Director at PhD Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Dr. Mehta is having 30 years of experience and represent industry with the government and the parliamentary committees, and even in the leadership role across the country in different verticals. My second panelist is Riku Daman Magon. Riku Daman is a director in Natural Group and Conserve Infotech Private Limited. Is one of the co-inventor of the core banking solutions and other banking solutions. And we have a young entrepreneur, Mr. Arjun Mishra. Arjun Mishra is the founder of Nabit India. And also he is awarded as the Queen's Young Leader 2017, Associate Fellow of the Royal Commonwealth Society. As a moderator, I am honored to moderate this webinar for all the participants. I am very much thankful to you to give me a this opportunity to moderate this. Okay, in this current scenario, what we feel, entrepreneurship and self-employment is a clear option for the people who are not able to find employment on their own. So self-employability is a good option for that. Being self-employed is a risk, but it's certainly option to being unemployed in general. However, if one doesn't have the skills and competencies needed to set up their own business, the entire endeavor is bound to fail. How does one build this? Are there training options in India we can fall back on? So my question to Dr. Mehta, that how these trainings for the entrepreneurs are helpful?
Yes, good morning, everyone. And this is very important topic today, that how, self-employment can generate further employment. Because if you see, we are passing through very interesting times in the human history. It is for the first time that we have seen more than 2 months of lockdown worldwide. Never ever we must have experienced such a disruption in supply chain, and all the economic activity had come to a halt. Seen that only during the crisis there have been many innovations and inventions. So I'm sure that during this time also we will have so many new things to see. Now, when you talk of employment generation, today we see one of the most critical problem is unemployment. And to do that, we need many enterprises. So it is mainly the micro small enterprises which are the backbone of any economy. If you see worldwide, out of all companies, around 70% companies are MSMEs, that is micro, small and medium enterprises. And in India in particular, 99.9% companies are MSMEs. We have, as on date, around 64 million companies which are MSMEs, and they generate more than 110 million jobs. So, Government of India has a focus. They have created an ecosystem, especially for startups. So, startup per se, anyone who has started business from 1st April 2016 onwards will be a startup. And it can be a private limited company or a partnership company which is registered. So that's what is a startup. I think the problem has been sorted out as far as the video is concerned.
Many thanks to Ashish.
Yeah. So therefore, this is extremely important. And I was talking about the ecosystem that has been created by Government of India today. It is particularly very important in Indian context, where more than 8 million people are coming into workforce, and that too for next around 4 to 5 years. Government cannot create so many jobs, and it is only the medium and small micro enterprises, they are able to generate these kind of jobs. So therefore, to focus on MSMEs has been there right now currently, and worldwide also we have seen any economy where there have been MSMEs, the economy has done very well. They have created lots of employment. And in India right now, between the age of 15 and 59 years, 62% population is between that that portion. And by 2030, we are going to have this portion will go around up to 65%. So that's what is the working population. Now, for that kind of burgeoning working population, we cannot create so many jobs. So the only answer is self-employment. And self-employment, especially focus on MSMEs, will take India, and they are the engines of growth. And there have been many opportunities as of today. When we look some of the initiatives of Government of India, they have focused on rural economy, and especially the weaker section of the economy, they have come out with Stand Up India. Now, Stand Up India, under this scheme, any entrepreneur, especially the scheduled caste and scheduled tribes and women entrepreneur, they can take a loan from 10 lakh to 1 crore. And it is mandatory for a bank branch to give at least 2 loans in a year to SC, ST and 1 to women entrepreneur. So that is the kind of focus the Government of India has. And this is being done through SIDBI also. There are so many schemes for this. And DPIIT is has created a very good ecosystem for startups. and there have been many incentives for the startups in terms of tax benefits in recent times. Now, when you look at the total ecosystem that has been created as of today, so there is huge focus, and this is the time where there are great opportunities. And our young generation, they have to become the employment generator, employment creator, job creator, not the job seeker. That has been the main focus of Government of India. Today, when we see our MSMEs, they contribute around 38% to the GDP, including service and manufacturing. So, yeah. Government of India has a plan to take it to around 50% by 2025, because they also have a vision of 5 trillion economy by 2025. So therefore, MSME is a great focus area. Now, there are three basic problems for small businesses or anyone. Every startup is an MSME, right? So for MSME, the main problem is right now today is a market access. Number one problem is a market access. Number two is a finance. The access to finance, and number third is access to technology. These are the three basic problems that the MSMEs are facing today. I think here, the Ministry of MSMEs has taken so many initiatives, and we have something called Government e-Portal. So Government e-Portal has been created. Earlier on, it used to be DJSND. Now it is Government e-Portal, where you only have to be Udyog, you have to have Udyog Aadhaar card, and those MSMEs, startups, they can register in Government e-Portal, and through that Government e-Portal, they can have access to all over the world. And moreover, the PSUs, public sector undertakings, have been mandated that they should procure at least 20 to 25% of their procurement from MSMEs. So that's a great advantage. Even in recent times, in this 20 lakh crore package, the Atmanirbhar Bharat package, which the Government of India has given, and this also, there has been a significant focus on MSMEs. So many, you know, reforms have been done, and one of the major reforms is, like, for tenders below 200 crores, they'll not be given to foreign companies. Only the Indian companies, MSMEs, can actually bid for this. And apart from this, there are huge other benefits for MSMEs right now. And the repo rate has been reduced to a historic low of around 4%. And these things have been, you know, especially the finance and technology has been, even the market access has been, has been addressed to a great extent right now. And this is the right time for our youngsters to come into self-employment. They should come into the schemes which Government of India has started. That is a Startup India, Stand Up India. These are some of the very beautiful schemes which they should take advantage. Ultimately, any nation which is going to be a superpower becomes not because of the arms, it becomes because of the economic power they have. And what is that economic power? It is the entrepreneurs. They create that economic power. So therefore, with more than 64.38 million roughly MSMEs in our country, and they are increasing every time, and they have been affected a lot during this COVID-19, but I'm sure that they know how to bounce back from this kind of a situation. Over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Dr. Mehta. So your version was very much from the government side, policies, decision that government has taken for the MSME. And you have rightly mentioned that 30% of the service sector. But my thing is this, I have also studied some data of MSME. There is a 7.09% of the contribution of MSME in the Indian GDP. Our Prime Minister says Atmanirbhar Bharat, and we need to focus on self-employment, entrepreneurship. Government has been started many things in terms of what you have said rightly in terms of finance and other things. But there is some missing, what I feel, as a young entrepreneur, what even they can feel, suppose I am an entrepreneur, I have expertise in something, say production, marketing, or in service, but I don't have other expertise. So I need to, either I need to get support from the government or from the third parties to scale up myself being an entrepreneur, so that the failure for the startup can be reduced, minimized. So you have rightly said that in your comments. If we remember, in mid 70s, US, Russia, even China also, our India also, we are almost at same stage. They people majorly have been focused on self-employment and entrepreneurship. But in India, we have focused on employment, like job employment, service employment. But in this, now we are in the era of pandemic also. The future of jobs, we are going for artificial intelligence, data sciences, data mining, distributed networks, many things now. There are new technologies. Many of people are not aware of that. But how we encourage people for the startups? There are a lot of challenges in India to become an entrepreneur. What I feel, number one, we need to conduct the even trainings also, but trainings may or may not be helpful for them, because the statutory things we are facing in India is very much difficult. These are the challenges to the MSME sector. So I would like to invite Mr. Repu Dhaman to comment on this and to share your experience on this.
Thank you, Shiv. It's a pleasure to be with you, and thank you, Whiteboard and Times, for organizing this. So if we look at the history of India, what we find is that we have created MSMEs and we have closed MSMEs. That has been our pattern, that we push MSMEs to be created and we close them at an equally fast pace. So it is not that we have seen MSMEs grow out, and this is not the first time that some of us are going to sit down and discuss how to create MSMEs, or this government is the first government to think on creating a structure for MSMEs. I will just go back 30 years when we were studying or doing our studies at BIT Mesra. So BIT Mesra is situated in Ranchi, Jharkhand, at that time Bihar. And outside BIT Mesra, there used to be a big setup of MSMEs who were created out of BIT Mesra students. They used to create those. So neither income incubation setups are a new thing for India. Let us look at what are the challenges which MSMEs face when we get into starting a business. First of all, we did not have venture capitalists for a very long time. Venture capitalist is a very, very common thing across the world except India. Our venture capitalists were probably Marwadis, who could fund a company and put their money behind us. Second, there is a big fear in Indian entrepreneurs that as soon as they give the majority stake, the company goes out of our hands. And we have taken, I'm still not sure whether we still have the government backing us on having 10% stake and still be able to run the company. We can check the stake of Microsoft, Bill Gates in Microsoft in the year 1999, not 2020. Go back to 1999 when the boom started and when the boom ended. What was the stake of Microsoft when he was, or what was the stake of Bill Gates when he was heading Microsoft? So these are actual practical challenges which a MSME faces when he wants to get into the market. Every banker would be ready to fund a project when he wants to start it, but there is no scope of the MSME to grow and market his products in the market and spend money on it. So you will find that our packaging is very poor. The product which is coming to the market is not at all market ready. it would be great. We can do great research. Some of our minds can do great research, come out with great products. But when we come to marketing, there is neither support from the banker side nor from the government. It is not something new which we are hearing that up to 200 crores now MSMEs can do and 20% of the sales or the orders have to go to MSME. These are all old laws. 45 days for the government to, for the MSMEs to get their payment. We just have to look at the structure from where the payment is stuck up. Government is the biggest debtor for all MSMEs put together. Our contractual laws are very, very, very poor. The maximum number of cases which are outstanding are check bounce cases. Yeah. So this is the right time for the government to act on every sector. They have to act on the judiciary. They have to act on the laws which are putting us down. What is the difference that why China, which started along with us, is the manufacturing, we may say boycott China, but let us see what we can produce after that. They are the manufacturing hub of the world, not India. So why do we lack? Why did we close down the MSMEs which were born or there in Noida? Just giving you a few examples which I have seen in my lifetime. We have closed down all the motherboard making factories in Noida. We have closed down all the TV manufacturers in this country. We have closed down the keyboard manufacturers of this country. We have closed down the... So you pick up the industry and we have seen it getting closed down. So what are the answers? How do we protect the MSMEs who have set up the company? How can they take it forward? So if today we talk of venture capitalists, let's see how much money has been given to companies in as a venture capitalist. Just giving a small example, a company of a size of a small MSME of a size of below 25 crores needs to put in investment to develop 10 new products, out of which probably one or two will succeed. How do they get the funding for the balance sheet? So that is where the challenge comes in India, where we have to go back to the bankers, to the government, to the venture capitalists, that they need to wake up to this fact if we want to make India Atmanirbhar. Words look very good. Practicality is very difficult. So I will open up. It's a good, very, very good time to be in entrepreneurship. For a very simple reason, that today nobody would like to lose a job. So you will have very stable employment. Any person who is going to put in money will put in money not because for the fun of it, but he will put money for development, for taking the company forward. There are going to be a lot of areas which are going to open up because of the pandemic. A lot of players who were there just for the fun of it will not be there. So I find it a very interesting time. Like every downturn, like what Dr. Mehta said, every downturn in the history gives a good opportunity for entrepreneurs to wake up.
Yeah.
And we don't spend money in this pandemic left, right, and center. We become intelligent suddenly. So let's hear the views of the others and let's take it forward from here. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. So you have shared your experience of, and whatever the problems MSME are facing. So what I want to bring in, see, there may be a job loss in future or presently that we are even listening or maybe we are looking also that there may be a job loss. So as our Prime Minister rightly said for the Atmanirbhar Bharat, how we encourage people for the startups, it is a what I feel it is a bigger challenge because many people don't want to take any risk. If I am an employed person, I would want to risk to do a startup. Because in future, what I am feeling, there may be a contractual job. If you are a specialist in data science, there is not permanent job for you. There may be a contractual job. If you are a specialist in AI, there is a contractual job for you. There's not permanent job. We need to educate, we need to train people to take a risk, a calculated risk for their startups. Government are here to help them. we are here to help them as you experts. So I think Dr. Mehta have something to say.
Thanks. Thanks. In fact, Mr. Ripu Daman has also made some point. So I would only say that, you know, like entrepreneurship is all about taking risk. Anyone who cannot take risks should not come into entrepreneurship. We should just look for a job. Because entrepreneurship is totally about risk taking. The bigger the risk you take, the bigger, the greater are the benefits that you reap out of it. And secondly, Mr. Ikudaman also cited some examples for what is happening on the ground level. Number one, we should always stop comparing ourselves with China. China is a communist country. What they are, they believe in the theory of expansionism. So we are not that country. We are a democratic country and with a federal structure. We have certain norms. Point is this, our judiciary right now, the enforcement of a contract is definitely a problem. Why we are, though in last 4 years, you can see that in World Bank ranking, we were 139, now we are on 70 rank, right? So we have done so many reforms, but only thing is what we have to do is enforceability of the contract is one of the very important thing that we need to focus on. And for that, we need to reform. We need to bring reforms in our judicial delivery system. That is definitely one of the point that we have to. So far as for MSMEs this is concerned, in last 5 years, there are huge number of plethora of reforms that have been made for MSMEs. The only thing is how many people today go and visit the website of msme.gov.in. How many people go and visit Invest India? How many people they visit the website of SIDBI or for that SIDBI or NSIC? These are the people. These are the people who are promoting MSMEs. The point is this: people here, come out with thousands of problems. But with the problem, if somebody can give a solution, a viable solution, that is the very welcome thing. India definitely lost our third industrial revolution, which took in electronics and all. Now industry for the fourth revolution, which is going to come. Now we are at the right stage. We can take a lead in this industry 4.0. And if we take a lead in this, in whatever way, so then nobody can beat India in the times to come. And the kind of fast growing economy that you have, our biggest advantage is that this is a country with 1.3 billion people, which can be mouth watering market for anyone in the world. I mean, we need the young population, which is coming into the workforce. They need to be motivated. They need to take the risk. And today, one of the greatest thing we have is the social media marketing, which is quite reasonably okay. Today, there are YouTubers who become stars within 2 months also. That also we have seen in recent times. So these are very interesting times and people come into self-employment and this is the right time. And India is the country which is to be looked for. It is definitely one of the most attractive destinations in the world.
May I interrupt, Shiv? There's been a question and I think part of it possibly Dr. Mehta has answered and part of it I think Arjun can answer. So I'm going to pose that question. It is from a lady called Shobha Bansal. She says, pre-existing businesses already face a lot of problems due to this pandemic. Then how can we think about being an entrepreneur right now? Very interesting question, very pertinent, to this particular webinar. Part answer, Arjun is the best person to give.
Very good morning to you, Shobha, and thank you for the question. Today morning, when I switched on the news, right, the first I was on some channel and something which prompted me was an image which read as hope is dope, right? So we need to be hopeful about a better future. And if we are that way, is when we create something in our minds and that eventually translates on the ground. Now, I tell you, as a pre-existing business owner who has been working for the last close to 9 years now, that I, under this pandemic times, and with all the economic problems which you're going to be facing, believe, and I'm very strongly so, that this is the best times that you can start a new enterprise for two reasons, which I've taken back my argument with. First, as a new enterprise or a new entrepreneur, you do not carry any baggage of your past performance, your successes, or your failures. What happens because of that is you are not burdened by any kind of expectations. Ripu sir, with an experience of maybe 10, 15 years, has a top line of his margins and profits which he has to justify to his stakeholders. You don't carry such burdens. That is one point. Second point, as entrepreneurship will grow, the government understands, and if you see what's happening, the trend going into the future, the number of government jobs being available are slowly and steadily reducing extensively. So the future for the country is only that we have to start our own enterprises, our own businesses. And the government is backing this very strongly. You see the access to credit, you see the availability of mentor network. These things have never been as, you know, conducive as it is today. So something which was being available, I can tell you my experience when I started in 2009 against today. The access to the network, you want to reach out to a particular person, there are platforms available, they are reciprocative to your messages, they give you the required mentorship, you want access to capital, that is available via schemes. Ranjit ji rightly pointed out, if you need to go and take that effort of going onto those platforms, you need to visit startupindia.com, you need to visit your MSME websites, refer to the schemes there. See, the chase has to be from you. You have to throw that energy around and you have to make the chase of going and closing things. That nobody can help you with. However, if you are having the intention, then there are ways in which you can achieve that, and those are, you know, easily available. So make that effort. This is the best time to start a new enterprise. That's all I would want to conclude with.
So, Arjun, just adding to it, I remember we had seen, I remember talking yesterday or day before when we were introduced to one another. In my lifetime, so it's not 10, 15 years, it's much more than that.
Okay.
So I have seen three major downturns.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever those downturns come, it's the ideal opportunity for entrepreneurs to get up, because that opens a vast, like, how do you function, work from home today? What would be the complete setup that a person would be requiring to work from home? So every crisis tells us that the existing entrepreneurs will have to rethink how they are going to work, and there are going to be a vast sector of opportunities which are going to open up for the new entrepreneurs like Shobha Ma'am would like to join in our league. So there would be n number of opportunities, like every day today, each one of us is having more than two ideas on our plate, if I'm not wrong. How the courts are going to function, how the our jails are going to bring the convicts to the court, whether they will be able to bring them, not able to bring them. So we had the thought of electronic peshi, e-peshi, sometimes in the year 2004 or 5, and 2020, 15 years down the line, it has to become something which is required, because you cannot function without it. How is voting going to happen? Because I would not like to go to the voting center. So is there going to be e-voting? People on the panel can go back and check. Gujarat government came out with a e-voting option sometimes in 2009 or 10. So there is going to be a huge amount of opportunities every crisis brings in front of us. So people are already working on them. All entrepreneurs need to open their mind and start looking at those opportunities. Second important thing which I was discussing again, we will not see people leaving their job. They may lose their job, but we will not see people leaving their job. So for the next 2 to 3 years, every company, every person is going to see stability, which is very, very important for an entrepreneur to start his journey. So they will find stability and they will be able to take forward that. Third, the problems that we have faced is that we never had, like, venture capitalism was a new concept when we came in at 1999. Probably we were the first company to get venture capital from SIDBI. So at that time, SIDBI had just opened there. Today, it's the most common word. People would be, and government is now coming out and giving you that protection. That is why I gave the example. We do not want to lose the control of the company, and we want to give away our shares And that is the law which we were waiting for, which has finally come. It took 70 years, but it has come finally. And we will all see that there are going to be huge amount of reforms in the land sector. Land will once again be available, which became a commodity not to be looked at in the last 7 or 8 years after the land, huge land reform act which we brought in. So people will be able to put up industry. It will not be costly. We will be able to get labor. We will be able to get stable employment, and venture capitalists are there to pump in money. And there are huge amount of ideas. Well, you can keep on listing the ideas and they will not end. Yeah, Sumit is waiting silently. So Sumit, why don't you remove that mute and start speaking?
Actually, I was listening all of you, and it was very actually knowledgeable thing for me. I just wanted to ask one thing, like in front of the panel, I believe that I will get the answer from you people, because see, Times Foundation like always work for the betterment of the society, and we work like from the organization like UN to very small organization like the SSG, you can say. So our teams in various cities, they work with women, basically the self-help group, you can say. They are not very much skilled in terms of computers or internet, etc. So I just wanted to know, what is your thought, like what is your suggestion for them to like so that they can develop, like they have skills, they have the capacity to do something. And I believe you also agree that we have started Lijjat Papad, now it is a brand. So what is your suggestion for those people who wanted to, who wants to start their businesses from a very small label, you can say a 10 woman group or 20 woman group?
So Sumit, I would request you see the growth which we have seen in Khadi Gram Udyog.
Yes, so that is my question, Mr. Ripu Daman.
Yeah.
Actually,
so that marketing push has come,
yeah,
which was lacking. That marketing push has come finally. You can say that we were very good in telling people to develop something. Finally, we have realized that we have to take it to market also. Every business plan has a go-to-market strategy. So that go-to-market push has come in the last 5-6 years. We find that happening. And with the opening up of the agriculture sector, the one single biggest reform which the government has done in the pandemic is opening of our agriculture sector. It is, again, if I go back, APMC reform was expected for last 15 years. So that is one big reform. Like, I do not know how many companies, like today also at 4 p.m., we have a call with one of the biggest banks in the country, that how they can push what the government is calling EASE 3.0 for the banking sector. So it's going to be a big, big, big opportunity for anybody and everybody who wants to see 70% of our economy suddenly opened up with one single reform. There is no state control, there is no control of APMCs. Do you know that why does our farmer suffer? He's not a businessman. So farmer does not lose money, but he never makes money. The money is made by people in between. Yeah. We have been hearing that aloo usne 50 rupaye ka becha, market ke andar 6 rupaye ka milta hai, why is this gap? So there is a company which is storing those aloos, there is a person, there is an entrepreneur who is storing them. There is an entrepreneur who takes them to the market. So this one reform itself is going to create a big, big, big change in our economy. So, how many?
Can I?
Yeah.
Please. Ranjit sir wants to add something. Please,
yes,
sir, go ahead.
Yes. Ashish, you, first of all.
Agriculture, we have not focused so much on this part. See, in this webinar, what I am expecting from my experts and my panelists, we have talked about the white collar people, right? They may be an entrepreneur, they may be startups in future, there are blue colors also, there are no colors also. Like our labor people who are
we lost you, you will have to repeat again.
Okay, I can repeat. So I have mentioned these three kind of labors in India, right? So how we can ensure, or how we can UK accumulate the non-color people to the self-employment?
Can I take,
for example, question? In agriculture that you have discussed, so Dr. Mehta, is there any things from the government?
Yeah, you see, you talked about migrant laborers, right? Now every state government, they are making a scheme.
So Dr. Mehta, my question to you, is there any government policy or any government decision for the non-collar people, if we encourage, if we promote them to be a self-employed people in agriculture, in horticulture, in floriculture, in tourism, in many of the things? Can you answer this?
Yes. You see, there is Ministry of Food Processing. As far as this agriculture and what Ashish also talked about is women self-help groups. One of the major, lacuna they have is that how to use the technology to market their products. Now, first, there's the first thing is there's a government e-portal, which is very important. Anybody who is doing business anywhere, government e-portal is extremely important. Now, in every district, there's a DI, there's a, from Ministry of MSME, there is one officer who is especially dedicated to help these small entrepreneurs. So people don't even know about it. So today, even we have time and again, we have requested the Ministry of MSME to come out with awareness programs, outreach awareness programs, which we have, from the Ministry of Food Processing, we have done it many remote districts of this country. What the problem is that there are many schemes, but people don't even know how to avail those schemes. Now, you talked about the non-collar job people. Of course, for doing any business, you should have some kind of capital, some kind of knowledge. Only then you can do some business, some kind of idea, you can do some business. Not that everybody can enter into business, but there are many micro businesses. Definitely. Like there are Chaiwala, there are other people, they are doing many small things. They are also micro enterprises. We are up to 1 crore, from 100 to 1 crore is micro enterprises. So the point is this: when we bring them into organized sector, for that they have to have a udyog Aadhaar, right? So as far as in in remote areas, in rural areas, the problem is there is APEDA. As far as agriculture is concerned, floriculture is concerned, horticulture is concerned, there is APEDA. APEDA helps people to export them from the country. Then there are SIDBI. SIDBI gives the loan. SIDBI is also there. Then there is a Ministry of MSME who have their officer in every district. So, in fact, there are schemes. The only thing is the people have to inquire from the particular district. And, though still there is red tapeism is still existing in all these places. But slowly, I guess, the things will be all right. There are schemes available. Even when you talk now in 27th June, we have now MSME Day coming 27th June. That is also about self-employment. Even in SDG, this SDG goal number 8 and 9, they talk about innovation, entrepreneurship, they talk about the economic growth. All this is pertaining to MSME only. So there's huge focus on self-employment, not only by the country, because they know that without supporting those startups, without supporting the self-employment, we cannot be an economic power of the world. Any country for that matter. Therefore, it has been included in SDG goal number 8 and 9. Self-employment has been included there, and this is a great opportunity right now.
Okay.
May I interrupt, Mr.
Sev? Actually,
May I interrupt, Mr. Sev? I just want to ask two things, one from Dr. Mehta and one from Arjun. If I heard correct, Dr. Mehta, you told that the businesses which were started before or by 2016, they come under the schemes which is available now. So what about those people who like right now wants to start their businesses? What all are the schemes for them? Because as per me, when I contacted banks, they are not aware about any scheme for new businesses. So please suggest something for the new businesses as well.
Yeah, new business means a startup, right?
Yes.
So Startup India scheme that is being taken care of by Ministry of DPIIT. So DPIIT, anyone who has started business from 1st April 2016 onwards, that includes today also at this moment, anybody wants to start with, that will come into the category of a startup business. So a startup business, the company, either it should be private limited company or it should be registered partnership firm or a company with a limited liability. All these kind of companies can be a startup company, and they'll be startup for next 10 years from the date of incorporation as a company. So that scheme is still on. Anyone who takes self-employment route right now, they may like to visit to the DPIIT website and also website of Invest India and see that what are the different schemes, what are different, you know, online everything is available today. So you can, there were times when to register a company, it used to take minimum 3 to 4 months time, but today it does not take more than 15 days. Though in places like Singapore, probably you can register a company within 2 hours. So that's a different, but at least from 3-4 months, we have come to around 15 days and everything is online. These are the, you know, ultimately, if we want to be efficient, if we want to bring efficiency and ease of doing business, technology is a great intervention. Technology is a great enabler. In all walks of our life today, the technology has been the main enabler. So therefore, I strongly believe anybody who is starting a business is in the era of now Industry 4.0. I mean, it has to be driven by processes. It has to be driven by technology. That is, I mean, those businesses will sustain in the long run. Otherwise, if manually managed businesses are without any certain process, probably, you know, they will start and then most of the startup, that is why they can't become a big company. So this is the difference. So technology is a great, great enabler. People will have to actually take up the technology and self-employment.
Sumit, thank you, Ranjit sir. You asked a very important question, which I think it's important. It's a very close subject to my heart, and that is about how can we work with SHGs and, you know, increase their capabilities and capacities. So I can tell you my hands-on experience that I have working with one such SHG, and I was being involved quite actively with the founder, who's a lady who's been working in UP East, Jharkhand in Bihar. And she has now made a SHG of close to 7,000 odd women who are working. And I slightly differentiate with what Ranjit sir said about having technological capabilities. Because let's understand that eventually we aren't a country which can depend too much on technology, because if we get into doing that, we have lots of people who are unemployed and we need to do justice to them too. So while technology is good and we need to enhance to the extent possible, I would want to answer your question on how can we work with SHG, stating the example of someone which I have worked with in the past. So what we did was, there were two things. Let's understand the end public, which is you and I, who would purchase the products of those SHGs, need two things. First, we have to associate strongly with the brand. For that brand association, we need to have a very good storytelling which needs to be done about this, about how the brand was formed, what is the essence, and who are the people who we are working with, and how the end public like you and I can participate into transforming the lives of the last mile poor who have some skills, can contribute positively. Unfortunately, the biggest problem they face is the lack of access to market, which we can, to an extent, solve. So while we talk about Atmanirbhar and so on, it's also important to start talking about the journey of such enterprises. So what did we do? So we identified 4 or 5 such products which do not require much level of, you know, training which will be involved in them. would have minimum mechanization in its production, in its production stage, and it would be profitable if it's done in huge numbers. There has to be a participation of a lot of people in that who form the SHG. Of course, there has to be certain quality standards which need to be met in the product which is then delivered, because storytelling and, you know, emotional connect is good, but beyond a point, if the quality is not good of the product, it won't sell to the masses. And of course, there are cost pressures. So we have in every category of the product, there's a competitor which is a branded entity, and he has his own marketing budgets, and also because of his huge capital, can reduce the pricing of the product substantially. And as the end consumer, we cannot compete with him. So where you cannot compete with a person, of course, you can assimilate into their strengths or work to their strengths and be a vendor, a supplier to them. So what did we do? So we created an entity of this close to 5,000 women who were getting different kinds of products, to name a few. One of them was about making spices and condiments. The raw material were procured in bulk. We had this huge SHG group who was working. Parallelly, we also did a huge marketing drive on social media about this brand, and we started talking about how we are impacting positively the lives of so many women across this region which we were working in. This brand, along with this, we also reached out to various government schemes which could help in making our product competitively priced and getting the quality and the technological intervention which will ensure that the end product which we are delivering would meet the expectation of the end customers, also would not be very different, differentiated from the price point. Bring down the price point initially, since we didn't have volumes, we also got the CSR of companies to be participating in it to subsidize the product initially. The idea was never that we will always have a cross subsidy which will be working in this, but we did understand that we can, till a point we reach a particular point in scale, we would require that in the initial period. Coming back to new opportunities coming in, when we had this group of women who were working across the SHGs, and then COVID struck us around the starting of, end of mid-March and the end March period. Suddenly there was a demand of huge number of masks which had to be built and which would be procured by the government itself through the local DC's office and the DM's office. You would be surprised to know we supplied close to 100,000 of, these masks which were made by these people, and those were procured by the government. We went back to the government asking for orders for such individuals. We had also ensured that the price differentiator should not be big. We're not talking about a difference of, because end of the day, it's a product which is priced as low as 5 to 6 rupees a unit. Now that was one supplier base in the government, but of course we can't have the machines, stop to work once we complete the government order. So we then went across the industry and we started marketing that product. And now I'm very happy to say that we have a steady flow of orders, which is coming in for close to 2-3 months now. These people are getting the basic pays of close to 8,000, 9,000 rupees sitting at home. And we have been able to get a lot of corporate orders, and we have reached to a point where we do not need any form of subsidy in our product pricing to make it match to the pricing point or the quality standards which the best of brands are delivering. So what I'm trying to say is that these kind of interventions can be worked out, these kind of things can be made. Eventually, it's not about whether it's possible or not, it's about how much access of information are we bringing to the end mile. If you're bringing that access of intervention, if you're getting the right minds to be matched with these enterprises, we can deliver great results on the ground.
I'd like to interrupt a bit. There's a question, and I think it's very valid, by Mr. G. Shivkumar, where he says, funding by banks and institutions are not readily supporting for many reasons, including short of information and also insisting of collateral security, discouraging self-entrepreneurs to really move on. So how would the panel respond to that, please?
Sir, I would like to answer that. In fact, it is the other way around. The banks are now going all out to support the entrepreneurs, the existing as well as new. Your business plan has to be equally solid. And I don't think collateral is an issue. We have been reading that for a very long time. It is open in all the forums, all the newspapers. We are talking about 10, 15 years, status of 10 to 15 years ago, not today. For the first time probably in my history or even whenever we have seen, we are seeing that the banks are going ahead and funding even the Khumcha Wala, sir, the roadside shops, they are being funded now. So I don't think that bankers are causing a concern. It could be a specific issue with a particular branch, but bankers are going all out to support the industry.
Adding to that, to substantiate the point of, you know, having why we should be having new startups, to what Ranjitji mentioned, apart from a startup which registers now, and if you have a unique idea which is actually worth its salt, you can also apply for tax breaks for the first.
Major tax breaks.
And you'll have a tax holiday which will help you in your, you know, conserving your capital and spending in a more better fashion. So you have those advantages. It is just that repeatedly we're trying to iterate on the same point. Many people aren't aware about the benefits, and it's because of that they aren't availing. So what I will, you know, emphasize on, let's stop complaining. Let's start searching. There are many more answers out there to be looked into.
Yeah, just continuing on the tax break part, I do not know how many people have the idea that if you invest into research and development, you get a 200% benefit in your return. You get a tax benefit of exact 100% of what you are investing into research and development. So we just need to go out. There are a lot of ideas to be implemented at all levels. I'm not saying, I will repeat again, farming sector is the most lowly paid area of our country, where majority of our population resides. And that is the area which is going to explode. So I'm talking like what Shiv said, that let's not talk about the IT sector, the blue collar. We are talking of the lowest level, the SHG level. There is going to be a major boom which is going to happen in that sector in the next 5 years. So like, you just have to start exploring and do spend time on your idea. When you get an idea, please remember, when I talk to my children, and they are now college going age, so I can tell you that if he or the my child says that so-and-so is ranked first in his school or in his college, so just remember, we have more than 1 lakh schools, so you are one in 1 lakh. So any idea that you are getting, remember there are lakhs of people with the same idea. You are not the one who is unique. I can tell you, if you get a unique idea, if you get an idea, stick to it, bang on to it, and you will succeed. I will just give you a very small example. We clicked on to one idea called bilinguality. Indian government says that anything that India does should be done in our language. We stuck on to that idea, and with a turnover of 2 lakh rupees in 1999, we got orders from banks like Punjab National Bank, United Bank of India, Vijaya Bank, you name the bank and we were there. With a turnover of 2 lakh rupees. So it is not that entrepreneurs are not supported, entrepreneurs don't. And on that 2 lakh turnover, SIDBI was ready to give us a venture capital loan of a crore of rupees at that time. So everything, today it is much, much, much more simpler and easy. So just go out, explore, but go with a solid idea, with a solid business plan. Don't just venture out because you got an idea in the night and tomorrow morning you cannot put it on paper. On a paper, make that plan. And for the smallest possible area, like if Arjun is saying that we were able to make mask is just one area. Like if you just, I will again repeat, go and see the results of Khadi Gramodyog, and they are purchasing from these SHGs, they are taking the SHGs to market. And best part, there was a complaint why the government is going to Big Bazaar and getting their goods sold. Why not? Why should I only put my goods in a Khadi Gramodyog Bhandar to sell? If Big Bazaar is giving me an opportunity to sell my goods, why should not I go to Big Bazaar, rebrand them in his name and sell them? So there are a lot of opportunities in that area, which are like, Arjun has something to say, so let him go ahead and
ask. Can I just, you know, highlighting my own story, right? I think one mistake which we generally do as entrepreneurs is that we get so passionate about our idea on the first, you know, the night it struck us, the next morning it's like we're going all gung-ho that we want to have it implemented so soon, as if the world is going to end maybe by day after tomorrow. So what's important is, many a times you forget that being passionate is one thing, but to ensure that this idea is having the monetization capabilities, we forget to do that. And we run around with the idea for so long and eventually dry out our resources that we find out that this was the wrong idea. I'll tell you my story. There were around 5 or 6 social enterprises which started along with Nabit in the year when we started 2009. Of which it's been around 11 years now, just 2 are existing. Of those 5, 6, who I'm aware of. Now, this is a very small sample size. The problem with them was they were passionate about the social cause which they were working with. The problem is that being passionate is one thing, ensuring that revenues is being, you know, scored eventually year over year, and there's a growth which this idea has to offer. That is the differentiator which we need to, you know, be very, very clear about. Second point about how small an idea can be. You know, till 2009, when we started Nabit, everyone used to believe that, you know, people with disabilities, they're worthless. There is no point investing in them, building the capabilities. Only thing which was thought worthy of them was, let's start a social, you know, an NGO or something where we go and ask organizations to give some grants, and that is how we will keep running the engines, and year over year, we'll go back with the same thing. So what did I do was that I changed the concept altogether. I reached out to, you know, organizations like Ripple Serve and said that please do not help me with any form of grants. I don't want your charity. I've built a skill set in my people with disabilities, which makes them as competent as anyone else in the industry. And based on that skill set, I'm asking you for the work. And I also, you know, request you to ensure that the people who you're hiring, who are my people with disabilities, are competent and can do your work to the professionalism expected from you. From a revenue, I'm proud to add this, from a revenue of from 2 people and revenue less than maybe 1 lakh for the first year, today we're clocking more than 2 crores in revenue. And it's been less than a 10 years journey. We're venturing to other things. We've impacted lives of 1500 people. Point is, from the day one, we were very clear on what are we offering, and we will not be changing that. And we had ensured that when we come to the pricing level expected and how are we going to monetize on unit metrics, we have to be positive at least from year 3. If we are not matching on these 2 conditions, please do not run with an idea which may you will find out to repent going forward.
Yeah, just continuing what Ashok said. Shiv, just give me a minute. There's a very small thing which we all need to understand. There is nothing known as NGO.
Exactly.
Please understand, if you do not have a business idea over there also, please don't run an NGO.
Give it to Chotu.
Thank you, Ripu. I think that was very well put. We do have a couple of questions. In fact, one of them was with respect to when Indian social enterprises can compete with American or European ones. I have answered that very simply on your behalf, saying that social enterprises should not compete, they should collaborate.
Yeah.
I hope I was not too wrong in that. And
I will further put it economically, that how our economy grows. And our economy got our first boost post 99 because of the land prices which kept on increasing. Then we got a boost from the banking sector which kept on pumping money into our economy so that we could grow. Today we can say that we were creating NPAs. But at that time, it seemed like a good policy to let the businessman have good amount of money and create more capacity and keep on growing. In the third phase, we need foreign funds now. We need those funds to come in big numbers so that we can collaborate with them and take our ideas forward. So you answered it 100% right, that it's going to be a collaboration. It's not going to be competing with them.
Okay. Thanks. Before we are going to conclude the session, I need only 2 minutes from Dr. Mehta also. Can we apply small supply chain model in MSME?
You see, supply chain has been a major problem that India has today. We spend around 15% of our GDP in transportation, when world over it is around 7 to 8%. One of the major focus of Government of India is to reduce the cost of supply chain in our country, the cost of transportation, which is very high. for that we need to have a seamless connectivity. So it's a multi-modal transport system that we'll have to make, which they are on the verge of making it. One is waterways, one is airways, then rail and roads. All these four needs to be integrated with the hinterland areas also. So this is the focus of Government of India. And we have 101 rivers which have been declared as national waterways. So because the waterways transportation is very cheap and the river goes into deep into villages and all those places. So this is a major focus which the Government of India is having. And, you know, creating that backward and forward linkages, especially with the agriculture, because today most of our people are dependent on agriculture. So, to bring those people into the main stream, as you said, supply chain, they have got such nice, spices or like for that matter, bamboo. See, bamboo, in Bangalore, they make a lot of agarbattis. But, you know, where do they get the bamboo from? They get from Vietnam. So from, you know, now that, I mean, they have simplified the law, they have made the reforms in the laws. So from now, from getting from the bamboo from Northeast, which are the MSMEs, of course, from Northeast to Bangalore, it will be easier. So here, I think that they'll have to create the linkages so that our transportation cost is cheaper. We know there are companies like Walmart in the world. They have made sustainability for themselves just because they have streamlined their logistic systems. So definitely there is a need, and it's very, very important point to streamline streamline the logistics in our country. And for why I am again emphasizing on this, one of the discussion point was for these potatoes, or if they are costing 1 rupee and in Delhi it is costing 25 rupees, because this has also been changed now. The APMC Act has been totally reformed. So this is a new thing. There have been more than 10,000 grams. Grams means Grameen, this Grameen Rural Agriculture Marketing, these boards have been made. So there are FPOs now, food processing organizations are there. So they can be done. It will be like courier service. Like once you take any village from there, if you want to supply to any main mandi in Delhi, so it is like there'll be a system where like it is a courier service, where the person who will collect all the produce, agriculture produce, and send it to the mandi, and in whatever money he sells it for, this, it will be transferred directly to the farmer. That kind of system is being made. So this way also many small entrepreneurs in the villages, they will get the employment.
Dr. Mehta, you need to clarify on that what was the earlier act? The because then the clarity will come that why it was stalling our progress in a big way, and how it is opening an opportunity for all people who are listening, that what opportunity awaits them in the rural sector because of the change in the APMC. Yeah.
You know, you are, Mr. Ripuraman, you are absolutely right. There's a huge opportunity in our agriculture sector because 60% population is dependent on agriculture. Until and unless we reform the agriculture sector, nothing can move up in the country. So therefore, in earlier system, what used to happen is the farmer was forced to sell his
Repeat that word. That if I was supposed to buy bamboo from Vietnam because I could not buy them from SRM
because
of this one app, was forced. Now just imagine in my company, I'm making a software, and if I'm told you can sell only to an organization in Jaipur and they will take it forward, and I would be killed.
Yes.
So this is what was killing the farming sector.
Yes. So this is one of the, you know, very exciting reforms that has been made by Modi government. And this will change the agriculture sector, and it will help in doubling farmers' income in by 2020.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Mehta. So,
and one more time, I want to give the name of the websites because for the benefit of all the people. For all the participants who are there, I mean, they can visit DPIIT website for a startup system to know about the Startup India, Stand Up India. They can search it. Number two, they can visit msme.gov.in, then NSIC, SIDWI, all these are very important websites where they can find for themselves. And government e-marketplace, they should definitely visit government e-marketplace, that is GEM, yeah, which is a market access for MSMEs.
So I would like to now hand over to Sumit ji for the vote of thanks to the audience as well as to the experts.
Yeah, I would like to thank all of you, Dr. Mehta, Mr. Ripudaman, Mr. Arjun, Mr. Sev, Mr. Rohit, and all our audience. Actually, it was a very insightful discussion which we had right now. And I believe that many of our audiences will get benefit out of it. And I hope you will get benefit out of the conversation which we have right now.
Thank you. Good day to all of us, to all of the audience, to all of you. Thanks for being here.
Thank you very much. Thank you.